garden. Little boy, wouldn't you absolutely love it?
For sure.
When my grandson was little, he would just...
Big little old boys love it too.
No way. Yeah, it's good that we're in the shade. Yeah. Right, where we are is the Armoured Corps Memorial Site. Where we are physically is on a salient called La Trône. And it dominates this hill that we're on top. When we go to the other side of it, you'll see it dominates Highway 1, which is the one we were on with the bus, linking Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. And its position was so strategic because it just simply saw everything that was on the road, which meant that all the convoys trying to come up to Jerusalem in the War of Independence in 1948 to relieve the blockade on the Old City and the Jews there were potshotted and sniped at and blown up one after the other. And dozens of people lost their lives on the way. And we saw it fleeting, but when we go up, the convoys themselves, the relics that were left over from that terrible war in 1948. And it was because of the Jordan Legion that was here. And they stayed in this Taggart Fort. And Taggart Fort was a British officer, Charles Taggart, who was brought out from India, who was an expert in quelling rebellions in India. They brought him out here in 1936 to 38, and he built some 72 Taggart-type forts, which is like a little mini fortress at strategic places that simply allowed the soldiers to live in, just like the Crusader Fortress at Belvoir that we were. This is a modern Crusader Fortress. And they were extremely effective. And because of that salient that was jutting into Israel, into the heart of Israel, Ben Gurion Airport is only 10 k's down the road, it had to be taken. Independence of Israel, 15th of May. On the 24th of May, the order was given to take the fort because it was just simply decimating the convoys going up. Two attacks, two assaults, all failed. So what did we have to do? We had to do what was called the Burma Road Alternative, which is another road in the valleys outside that they found a little windy track, and within 10 days opened up a road sufficient for convoys and trucks to go through, bypassing this salient that was dominating the valley of Ayalon. And the Ayalon Valley is an important valley throughout history because that's where Joshua fought his battles. Again, that's where Judah and Maccabee fought against the Seleucid, the Greeks. That's where Jesus and Emmaus took place. One after the other, the battles that are in the Bible, but we're not doing that today. But because of its flat terrain, it had to be taken by any conquering army. Only in 1967 did we manage to take this off the Jordanian Legion when we conquered the West Bank and threw the Jordanians back to the eastern side of the Jordan River itself and then took over there. And the building itself, we'll go in later because they'll show us a film on the Armored Corps itself, will allow you to see some of the historical side and the tanks and the warfare that went on here. And you'll see all the pocket marks, you can see them even here, all the bullet holes that we go through. Very hard fighting. Arik Sharon, a famous general in Israel, was also wounded in one of the fights trying to take it back, but we failed in 1967 did we manage to take it on. Then they gave this site to the Armoured Corps and they established a memorial site. Now, over there, the names, have a look. It's simply, the names don't mean to you, but have a look at the number of people who have died since 1948 defending the State of Israel from the Armoured Corps. So this is a very emotional site for a lot of parents who come out here the day before Independence Day, which is Memorial Day, to honor the dead. And then 24 hours later, we celebrate the independence of the State of Israel. A complete transition between a heavy, somber day and then the next rejoiced day for who we are in the Free State of Israel. And they put together this tank museum. It has 110 tanks, one of the largest museums in the world, of tanks from all over the world. They've got T-72, they've got T-62s, T-55s, they've got Leopards, they've got British Centurions, but they've got the massive ones at the top, the Merkava, right at the top that we aim to head through now, which is considered among the top three in the world. And when we finish that and we come down, we'll be able to wander around and you can clamber wherever you're allowed to go up on the tanks and see the actual Merkava. This will give you an opportunity to see a tank cut in half so you can see what it's like to be cooped up in this little strip of metal here with four people trying to function and a 19-year-old kid telling you what to do. That's something. Right, let's go into the building, guys. So we'll see the film and then we'll come back and we'll be able to clamber around like little kids. Well, you guys can. I've done my clambering. That's it.
Yeah.
Pardon?
What years were these?
These were from, this is the Merkava 1. This is already in the late 1960s. They were producing that, late 60s. So we'll just, and this is an old one. It's not the most advanced one. We'll just wait for everybody to come out and we'll put it into perspective. That allowed Israel to put itself on the map in terms of the armaments industry. There are obviously a number of major projects ranging from the Navy to the Air Force with that magnificent plane called the Lavi, the Lion Cub, that was squashed by America because it simply was too advanced and it meant that Israel wouldn't have to buy planes off them. So they simply squashed that project for us, which would have allowed us to produce our own most advanced aircraft of that time. And we're talking back 20 years ago that they forced us to close the industry down. But the armor, and let's not forget, we're talking about the wars of 67 and 73 and the first Lebanese war, was these beginning of the tanks, the Merkava, the chariot. And again, by today's standard, these are giants. But the Merkava 4 and the Mark 5, that's about to come out. So this was the first, the second, the third, a completely different style of tank to what you're used to seeing around the world. So if these were giants, that was a behemoth, and we're about to see that. Probably the most advanced systems today, alongside the Abrams and the Leopard of Germany. But these were something that was outstanding. The hull, have a look at the hull, the shape of the hull and the deflective armor. This again, 60s, 70s, 80s. But the big one that we're going to see now, and you can clamber up and have a look, is the Merkava 4. And that is something that's completely different and special because it has reflective paint against to lower its thermal image for radar spotting. It has special plumes on the engine to reduce the heat coming out and mixing it with air particles to reduce the image of infrared to the night spotters at night. But it has on it what's known as the windbreaker. And the windbreaker is the most advanced protective anti-missile system today in the world that is placed on our tanks, that's able, and it was proven to be exactly what it does in the Gaza campaign in October 2014 when they fired Sagar and RPG's missiles. It detected them, it throws out these little projectiles and pellets and keeps the tank crew 100% safe. The amount of armor that it's got, the reflective side of it, but the modular plates. It's made of composite material, but the modular plates divided by between two layers, which means if it penetrates the first, it won't penetrate the second. That's something for the tank crew to be inside to understand that the safety feature is the number one priority for these tanks itself. Now they're clambering overseas armies to buy that protective system because no one else has it in the world. Only the Israeli Defense Forces. And that is the latest tank in the world. You're looking at an enlarged gun of 120 millimeters. It has 50 rounds. It has high explosive shells. It has flechettes. It has phosphorus. It's modular in the sense that if it got hit and they had to replace a part, they just simply replace that section. You don't have to take off the whole tank and take it back to the garage to replace the parts. Take off the damaged part, put the next in, and away you go. The engine, 1,500 horsepower. It can hit 64 kilometers an hour. It weighs 65 tons. It can travel 500 kilometers on the 1,200 liter tank. It is a house on its own, but it also carries, apart from the crew of four, it carries at the back, and you'll see it, where they can open up and carry six soldiers in complete safety right up to the front lines without them having to come on APCs and be open to pinpointed shots by the snipers themselves. So this is the most advanced tank today. You can see a complete revolution from these ones that were thought to be the best. But have a look at the angles, which means if it gets hit, it deflects off. You'd have to be really something special to be able to knock off one of these turrets off it. The turret is dry, which means there are no active rounds inside the turret. Every shell is encased in a fireproof canister, which means if it gets hit, it explodes right there. It doesn't explode the other shells out. Again, another safety feature that they've got that was developed here. So it's a completely dry turret, the crew inside there, which is a gunner, a driver, the commander, and the loader. Right? So you can wander around, have a look. It's not the normal 7.62, it's a 12.7mm machine gun, really heavy caliber. This is something that gives us the advantage over the other side, and obviously gives the tank crew, now that's not to say that you can't get hit, obviously you can, but it gives them the feeling of confidence that with that, they've got their chance of survivability is greater than anything else out of these. These are child's play. These are nothing. So they're great as a museum piece that will wander around and have a look. But this is the one. Climb up, guys. Get in front. Take a photo. Get in front of it. We'll take a photo of all of you guys here. You can clamber up on the tank. Just be careful coming up. But you can sit on the turret. It's okay. That tank isn't going anywhere, so don't worry about it. The keys are in my pocket. Sit on the turret. That's it.
Straddle it.
Hey. What's this straddle it bit?
Straddle it.
Thank you very much. We've got religious people here. What's going on here? What's going on? Guys, come in. Stand in front. Stand in front.
Give me a try.
We'll take a photo. Stand by the tank, guys. We'll take a photo of all you guys. We got any tank, ex-tank people here? We got one?
APC.
Who was in the Armour Corps?
Hey. No, I was in
Resident. Yeah?
In tanks.
Oh. You were in convoys?
I was in Armour Corps. Well, I was in the CMM.